John, can we sort of start at the beginning? Can you talk a little about your first experiences and how you got involved in basketball, mm-hmm. and then talk about that impact that it's had on you?
Hello. I'm not a sports fan now, and I wasn't a sports fan when I first picked up a basketball. I generally think that it's men being boys, really, in male team sports especially. When I was young, I liked two things primarily. I loved books and I loved pie. Those two things were, my world revolved, or rather they revolved around me. And probably up until I was 17 years old, I had almost no involvement in sports aside from mandatory PE. And in my school, that involved playing rugby, which I thought was ridiculous to do something where I was essentially the biggest target on a field. I started playing basketball because I walked down Market Street in Manchester one day when I was 17, and a man came up to me and said, "You'd be great at basketball." And the reason I did it was not because I knew anything about basketball, because I did not. It was because it was the first time in my entire life that someone who wasn't my mother told me I could be great at something. And I was absolutely dumbstruck. In the middle of a street, surrounded by a crowd of, you know, people streaming by, and a man just told me I could be great at something. And I was like, tell me more. And that's how I got involved. I ended up going to a tiny little gym and playing my first basketball game and first basketball practice, and being really terrible, being truly abysmal. The thing I remember about being first involved in basketball was not, the sport itself was important, I suppose, but to me, it was the idea that I was surrounded by a group of people, and every time they looked at me, reflected back, I saw my potential. And I think that's quite a transformative thing for a young person. Because our identity, I mean, I'm a psychologist nowadays, and I tend to get somewhat geeky with this, so, but our identity is not just us, we've not just decided on it. It's also a reflection of how we see ourselves reflected in other people. And so for me, everywhere I went, I was a monster. Because that's how people react to me, generally. If I'm not wearing a suit, anywhere in London, people will cross the street to avoid me after dark. If I'm not wearing a suit, it's very difficult for me to get a taxi in London. And generally, when I'm around people, if I'm not in a suit, people make assumptions about my capabilities, intellectually and otherwise. And that really resonated with me when I was young. People just thought I was this scary freak. And then I got involved in basketball, and suddenly these 12 people around me are looking at me like, "You could be great." And it was intoxicating. It was like, that was the day I decided. I mean, that first practice was the first day I heard of the NBA. I had to ask somebody what it meant. And when they told me, I was like, "Yep, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to play in the NBA. And then they looked at me and they were like, "Yeah, seems reasonable." 17-year-old fat kid with a pie in his hand. Sure, why not?
And you know, what was interesting to me about your story is very early on you had a big hurdle to cross. So if you want to hold up your right hand, you can probably see there's a scar across here. So why don't you tell the story about actually what happened to you?
I'd been playing basketball for a few months, and then I went on a biology field trip to Anglesey with my school. You know, it's a fun away trip. And on that one evening there, I ran back into the chalet, and the door was closed, and I did what my mother's always told me not to do, which is to push a door open with the glass, and I pushed the door open with the glass, and my arm went right through the glass. And actually, I was not cut. I've got a tiny little cut just here on my forearm, and that's the only cut I had. And I remember thinking, I'm the luckiest man alive, because I'm going to play in the NBA, and this would have been devastating. And so I'm pulling my hand slowly out from this pane of glass, and suddenly a piece of putty drops on the top of my hand, and I look up, and the glass drops and chops my hand. Every nerve, every tendon, every artery on the top part of my hand. And my hand was just hanging open. My best friend, still my best friend to this day, despite the fact that I sprayed him with arterial blood. That's a sign of a true friendship. And so I kind of, he threw me a tea towel, and I kind of pulled my hand together and wrapped it up, and then went to the teacher's place and said, yeah, I think I need to go to the hospital. Understatement.
And you couldn't use your hand for 9 months.
Yep.
And so only a relatively short period of time into basketball, you could have just packed it in. Mm-hmm. But you did something different.
Somebody told me I could be great. And when nobody tells you that for 17 years, and then somebody tells you it, and then 11 other people tell you it right afterwards, you don't let that go. And so I went back, and I had a cast, this amazing contraption on my hand that held my fingers up, because often when you damage tendons, your fingers turn into claws. And so with that on and bandaged up, I played basketball left-handed. I learned how to catch one-handed, dribble, shoot, everything. So I was ambidextrous at that point, which is very handy for basketball. Not much else, actually, but for basketball, it's hugely advantageous.
So roll forward, you get into basketball, you improve, but you've got your heart set on being in the NBA.
Mm-hmm.
And you go to your mother and you say, I need to go to America. And you have an interesting discussion around what you want to achieve, and you create the plan.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, can you talk a bit about the plan?
When I told my mother I was going to go to America and go to university, she said, well, how are you going to do that? It sounds challenging, she said. And I said to her, I remember the first thing I did was I stood in the window and I just kind of pointed at myself and I was like, this. And there certainly aren't that many people as tall as me. And I just thought I was really rare, like a unicorn. And that by virtue of being this tall, that alone would kind of propel me forward. So I just kind of pointed at myself like, yeah, right? And then I told her I would go to America, I'd get a scholarship, because those are easy to get. And then I would play for 4 years. And then I would be drafted to the NBA career. And I told her I'd buy her a house as kind of a cherry on the top. And she made it clear that she didn't think that was going to work that way. And she said the strangest thing. She didn't say she was quite an esoteric woman, my mother. And she said, would you recognize your soul in the dark? And exactly, right? So that's exactly my response when I was 17. What? And she said, well, you're trying to do something nobody else has done. You're trying to travel a path that nobody else has trod. I said, most people who want to do well-traveled, well-trodden things, they're like a stick in the river, she said. You throw a stick in the river and eventually it may get caught in some weeds, it may get caught in some eddies, but eventually it'll get to the estuary. It just happens. But for you, you need to know yourself. And that was the beginning of the plan, the idea that I would gain an understanding of myself. I would recognize my soul in the dark, be able to describe myself beyond what I look like physically, what I like and what I don't like, to actually understand the roots of the things that motivate me, to actually understand the things that might sabotage me in the future. Because the truth is, I'm exceptionally lazy. It's just that I know that, and so I'm rarely tripped up by it. Because I know that I'm lazy. I arrange my life in a way that it's not possible for that to dominate. Whereas most people ignore the bad things about them. And then they look around in wonder when the bad things about them trip them up, usually at the most crucial moments. And that's what the plan was about. It wasn't this rigid, first of this, then this, then this. It was, how do you make decisions? I mean, for example, when I went to find a trainer, I knew what kind of person I was and what kind of trainer I needed. I didn't need somebody who yelled and screamed. I needed somebody whose disappointment would be the most profound, moving thing for me. But I also knew that I'm fundamentally lazy. And if I find a trainer and I live far away from them, then there'll be mornings when I just say, too tired, not going. So instead, I found a trainer, and then I found a little one-bedroom efficiency. It was in Phoenix, Arizona, where this trainer was. One-bedroom efficiency that when I opened the curtains in the morning, I could see my trainer through the window right next door. And every morning I opened the curtains, and even when I didn't feel like doing it because I was lazy, he would kind of poke his head around. It's like, now I've got to go to training. There's something profoundly important if you want to achieve real greatness about knowing who you are in the first place. So the plan was rooted in that in the beginning, but then also was much bigger than basketball. Because basketball's, when you boil down what you do for a living, this can be a dangerous thing, so I'm just warning you, don't do it unprepared, but if you boil down what you do for a living, it can often be quite disappointing. People often rave about basketball players and athletes more broadly, and every day I wake up knowing that I have to make up for the fact that for 20 years of my life, I put a ball in a hole. I mean, how dumb is that? It is perhaps more dumb that someone paid me to do it. But there's nothing noble about it. There's nothing... I mean, when you say it like that, I'm an entertainer at best. Most people would say not a very good entertainer, but, you know, so... the plan had to be bigger than that. It had to encompass the kind of life I wanted to live and the kind of things I wanted to do. And the truth is, way before I discovered basketball, I knew I wanted to be a psychologist. I knew that would be the thing that was enduring and had a bit of legacy to it.
Let's talk about another aspect. So let's talk a little bit about inclusion. Talk a little bit about your kind of role in the team, the way you interacted with people, the way that they engaged with you. You were really a core part of the sort of senior leadership, actually at a very early stage in your career.
Yeah, I mean, I think inclusion is not just about obvious or protected classes or obvious demographics. Really, inclusion is about seeing people as individuals, not just as job descriptions. I played in Orlando. It was kind of my heyday, if I even had a heyday. And when I first got there, you know, I'd spent the summer with the summer program, and so maybe 14, 16 weeks I'd been with the team. We'd been on a few away trips as part of preseason. Then when the season started, the seating arrangements were different somehow. We get to the plane, we have our own plane, every team has their own plane, and you get on board, and suddenly I'm you can have that one. And it's a top table, it's a four top table seat that they say, you can sit down. And suddenly we take off, and a guy, player, stands up from his seat with somebody else and comes and sits with me. I put my computer down, and I was like, hello. And he's like, Meech, they call me Meech, because John is too difficult. Meech, I've got a problem. And I suddenly, right there, boom, I was like, now I know. In the 16 weeks that we've been together, you have identified that it is not just me scoring 10 points a game that's important, playing a bit of defense and passing occasionally, that there is another role that I need to play for us to win. And here it was. My first challenge as a kind of pseudo-psychologist on my team was, Meech, I've got a problem. My girlfriend and my wife, they just don't get on. And you suddenly realize, and that's the thing about inclusion. We would have been a perfectly serviceable team had we all just done our jobs on the floor. But the reason that team was special was that everybody had some additional role that they could play, because we really saw people as individuals who might bring something amazing and surprising to the table. And that's what inclusion is all about. Even when it came to the discussion about me being gay, I was sit at the table. 11 members of my team are stood at the front of the plane, gathered around two top tables where the captain sat, and they're talking, and every once in a while, one of the players keeps on looking at me, and I'm working at my laptop and pretending I don't see this. And then Monty walks down the gangway towards me and says, Meech, you don't talk about women much. And I said, indeed. And he said, cool, all right. Then he went back, spent about 2 minutes in that huddle, and then they all dispersed, and it was like, that was it, done, sorted, no issues. It was amazing. They made it, I mean, it was still odd, but it worked. I felt like I was included.
And with that, you really felt you were able to perform at the best of your ability.
To me, it's like the scene from Mary Poppins, right? Everybody's seen Mary Poppins. You have. And there's a scene where she opens up her carpet bag and she starts pulling out stuff, right? Pulls out the coat rack. She pulls out amazing stuff out of this. And the thing is, it's ridiculous to say if this were realistic, but if it were realistic, really, she would pull out something and her knickers would be on it, right? Because that's what happens. When you reveal stuff about yourself, bits of your identity hang off it. And so if you're afraid that people will laugh or deride you because of the bits of your identity, they just stop pulling stuff out of their bag. Or they just stop bringing their bag to work at all. In which case, you're just left with a job description, which is cool if you want to be average. But it won't work if you want to be great.